So 1987, that was the year when my favorite band, Depeche Mode, released their sixth studio album titled Music for the Masses, big time. Right after that, as usual, in the 80s, for this kind of bands, they went to a world tour. And then 1988, spring, March, 9th of March and 10th of March, they gave two concerts in Budapest. And I was lucky enough to be there on the first night with my friends. And I was thinking still, really big times. And then I wasn't and still not sure if this beyond consciousness as a phrase, if it exists, but I'm pretty sure that I was in that state of mind in that night. because I was 16 and whatever. I was also, and after that, for weeks or months, we were talking about this. This was the main focus everywhere among friends. And I was, wondering, and I'm still wondering if we had the same feelings during that night when we were shouting together Strange Love and those kind of lyrics. We can't be sure about this. And, well, let me say that this is maybe the first problem as being scientist to investigate or consider consciousness, that what should be the definition of it? Because we don't know how the others are feeling, and it's definitely related to that one. A recent paper by Kuhn, he was actually coming up with about 200 different definitions of consciousness, all valid and stuff, but representing the kind of diversity and a little bit of confusion among scientists. Not necessarily from there, but I'm picking up a relatively simple definition of consciousness, which is exactly subjective experience. So I'm going to use this definition in this talk. And this resonates perfectly with my experience at that Depeche Mode concert, which is really the one of the focal points in my life. Okay, back to 1988. This was the age when AI, so artificial intelligence, I'm going to call it AI, was in the so-called winter stage. What is that? AI, first of all, which we will discuss, but what is AI winter? So it happens that even fancy and well-financed research areas are getting less and less interesting, and then maybe scientists are not able to come up with significant progress in research and stuff. And then that is actually usually the consequence of the lack of finance. But that was happening around that time. As a matter of fact, it was already the second winter, by the way. Currently is definitely AI summer this time for a couple of years now. But anyway, what is AI? Okay, that should be a long, long discussion, and usually we spend a semester on it, even just to define and get a grasp of it. Or there are even master programs named after this. So, you study for 2 years what AI is, and then even after that, you are kind of confused. But this one, I am confused, okay, not you. This one is a mantra which we usually teach on an AI course, and keep on chanting, maximize your expected utility. Okay, due to lack of time, I still have 5 minutes or so. I'm not gonna detail all these words one by one, but nevertheless, maximize means that you wanna achieve your best solution, let's say. Expected means that we are in a probabilistic environment, noisy environment. Utility is a good thing to measure performance and goodness. And you, is, well, either you or me or our computer, which is running some kind of program which is capable of doing this maximizing expected utility. Okay. My argument is that a theoretical AI is super cool. If I was an AI researcher, then I would do theoretical AI, but what's the big deal about it is that it's applicable. Okay, and it's so much that last year the Physics Nobel Prize went to computer scientists because of their contribution to AI, especially artificial neural networks, which is the basis of this so-called deep networks and deep nets, and then all these kind of things which you hear about all the time. And then I think it's, you know, this thing wouldn't happen if there was no application of AI, and then AI, if it wouldn't be our part of our everyday life, then these guys, they wouldn't be recognized by the Nobel Prize in Physics. The question is so we apply AI on computers. Okay, what are the computers? Then, you know, we are doing it progressively. Computers are for computing, of course. What they do is that they make calculations on stored data, more or less. This is a very brief definition. And amazing thing happened in 1936 when Alan Turing, the famous mathematician, came up with this seminal paper in which he defined the so-called Turing machine. Okay, now what is amazing about this is that you can see maybe a photo there, and that's a physical demonstration of a Turing machine. Of course, the theoretical version has infinite tape, which you can see here. Of course, those white tapes are that is actually a finite thing. So that is one difference, but there are other details. But nevertheless, it's so simple that this tape can be moved left or right, and then that head in the middle, it can read or write into that tape super simple symbols, and more or less that's it. And then what is amazing, it's not a theory, but a theorem, so, you know, proved thing. What is written there, that anything a real computer can compute, a Turing machine can compute. So let's put it this way, that actually whatever computer we have, digital or analog, then it's basically equivalent to this Turing machine, which is amazing. I mean, you know, it's such a visionary thing that, this is truly amazing thing and truly amazing fact. Okay, what can we do with a computer? Well, we definitely don't use it to solve, quadratic equations in which we just plug in the numbers into a formula and then get the result. Of course, what we are doing on a computer is we are executing algorithms. Okay, an algorithm, for definition, a finite sequence of mathematically rigorous instructions. Okay, now, just to let you know, if you wonder that algorithms are basically recipes, then no, because a recipe book can contain such a description that you put just enough salt into your soup, so then it's definitely, that part is definitely not rigorously defined, right? So then we shouldn't say that an algorithm is a recipe, but loosely speaking, it is, but it's not, okay? It's not, but loosely, yeah, okay. And then further on, these algorithms are intended to be implemented, so programmed, as a computer program. So then we are arriving to this question, which I already answered no, is it possible somehow to make up such an algorithm which is a programmed consciousness? Okay, we don't really have the definition, the precise definition of consciousness, but, you know, hypothetically. And then my answer is no. And then kind of argument for this is that, if you have this program and you want to execute it on a computer A and computer B, then you get exactly the same result because these are just Turing machines, all the same. So then there is no subjective with the subjective experience. There is no such thing there. I need to mention, sorry, I'm running out of time, but I must mention the other contribution, one of the other contributions of Turing, Alan Turing, which is the Turing test. Okay, he was proposing this to measure intelligence. Okay, and then the question was whether, so you need to decide whether you are speaking to a computer or to a human. Okay, you can ask questions, you can propose discussion, and then finally you have to declare, okay, I was talking to a human. And then if this is the case, and then if it was a computer, then that computer or program passed the Turing test and then declared as intelligent. Now, what is interesting here is that, well, first of all, AI is not for creating machines or algorithms passing the Turing test. You know, this is fancy and stuff, but AI researchers are not working on that. Second is that it's interesting that it's using verbal interaction. Okay, if I'm typing on my computer, then let's consider that one also verbal, okay, for now. So verbal interaction, and then same goes with consciousness. Know that if you want to know if I'm conscious or not, then you would be asking me, right? So question, verbal questions. Are you all right? How do you feel? This kind of thing. So very similar things are there. Yet consciousness testing, I don't know. Okay, finally, about the title. What is it like to be a machine? Okay, very cool title, I think. When I was preparing for this talk, then, I did my homework, and then I looked up some related works, literature, and everything. And, of course, I bumped into this very famous paper by Thomas Nagel, saying entitled, What is it like to be a bat? Okay, from 1974. So I was thinking, okay, this is cool. I'm tweaking it to like computer and machine. I let you know, I'm not going to answer this, by the way, in this talk. But I wanted to be sure that I'm kind of original. Okay, and then one way to do it is that you step away from the circle, for example. You declare yourself original, that you don't follow the rules. And the other thing is that, you have this phrase, and then you look it up on Google, right? And then I did it, and it turned out that there was a couple of hits, even the exact phrase, but not much. So I felt, okay, this is going to be okay. And then what is funny is that there were lots of hits saying, what is it like to be a machine learning engineer, which is actually the guys who are sitting behind the computers and then doing AI, programming AI, and then blog entries about that thing, which is, of course, completely different. Okay, so by the way, these generative AIs, such as ChatGPT, they are also learning everything from the internet. As a matter of fact, they only know what is it on the internet, right? And then I think, and many experts says that, okay, this is the huge difference between computers, generative AI and us, that we are creative and we know things without the internet, right? That's for sure. And then animals, they definitely don't have access to internet, right? And still they are creative, and some of them are believed to be conscious, okay? So that's a huge difference. Okay, now concluding. Right, concluding. I think right now AI systems are not conscious, and they are not going to be, at least these currently existing algorithms. Yeah, but we need to be careful because, for example, if I had a time machine, and then went back to like 50 years ago and then show ChatGPT to AI expert or neurobiologist, then they would say, come on, this is amazing. This is conscious. This is conscious. So we need to be careful with this because sometimes there could be shift in technology, right? And then just to remember that at the time, in the beginning of the previous century, when the Wright brothers were flying, then I think just 69 days before, there was a big article in New York Times saying that it is impossible. In 1 million years ahead, maybe we will have flying machines, but not now, definitely. So we got to be careful. And but anyway, if that happens, then that's another issue, you know, because then it's ethical, all ethical, right? So right now we are closing our computers in order to let them sleep, and that's convenient. But after you have a conscious AI on your computer, then you better be careful, charge up your battery all the time, because you don't want it to die, because then you are in ethical trouble, okay? But that's that ethical issue is a part of another talk, so I'm finishing. This talk was dedicated to my mother. Anyuci, and nagyon szeretlek. I love you all. Thank you very much.